Praise the Lord. We've been embarking on a study. I call it the study of the book of Revelation, but the reality of it is it's about end time events. Amen. The big word that they use, the scholarly word that they use for that is eschatology, meaning the study of end time events. And so we've been just kind of digging in. And where we started a while back, and I'm not going to really belabor this point, but I do like to do a little bit of reviewing. Where we started a while back was we compared the Jewish wedding feast and the typologies connected to that to our betrothal or our ultimate marriage to Jesus, if you will. And once again, I really can't. We have it on YouTube, and if you're interested in that, you can go check that out. But the scripture is rife or full of typology of marriages, right? There's multiple marriage parables. The great Eliezer call, if you've ever heard someone say that. I know Brother Swagger and them say it all the time. The Eliezer call, which talks about the fact that Eliezer was Abraham's servant. Amen. Abraham, a type of the father. Isaac, a type of the promised seed. You understand that Isaac is a perfect type of Christ in the sense that her womb was barren. Amen. And when all hope was lost, he came forth as a promised seed. Amen. A promised child. And the reality of it is that the Lord told Abraham, you need to take that boy up on a mountain that I'm going to show you. Amen. And there you're going to sacrifice him. And the word of God says that Abraham put wood on the lad's back. I mean, if you can't see Jesus toting the cross up that hill with that, hallelujah. And he carried that cross, he carried that wood up that hill, and he ended up being laid down on the altar, and Abraham was about to take his life, but the Lord stayed his hand and said, no, you don't have to do that. And I believe that's where the Lord showed him. I'm not preaching that, but it's real clear to me in the scriptures. I can delineate it for you that the Lord showed Abraham, this is what I'm going to do for the human race. Hallelujah. I mean, before God foreseeing that he would justify the Gentiles through faith, preached the gospel in advance to Abraham. 2,000 years before Jesus was ever born, God preached the gospel to Abraham. And ultimately, Paul tells us that the promise of the seed that would be a blessing to all the nations wasn't multiple seeds as of many, like the nation of Israel, but instead one seed, which is Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. So God showed Abraham. He probably saw more clearly than most of us in the church. Anyway, what we're talking about, that was the Eliezer call. The father had a promised son and wanted to fetch a bride for his son. Amen. And so Eliezer, the servant, is a type of the Holy Spirit to go get Rebecca and brought her back. And you know, the Jewish wedding is a similar concept that the bridegroom would come and offer the bride a marriage contract, and then there would be a purchase price that would be agreed upon. Amen. And Jesus came. First, the bridegroom would have to come to the bride's house, and and Jesus came, amen, to earth, the incarnation. Hallelujah. And he offered a purchase price. He offered himself on the cross. And then that started what you call the betrothal period, which is like our modern day engagement. And so the betrothal would take place. And the word literally in the Hebrew it describes sanctification, separation. So the bride is to be separated out. She's waiting for the bridegroom to return. Amen. And so that's where we kind of got started. And really, I built all that because, listen, we're taking a whole fresh new look at the book of Revelation. I'm not going to get into that too deep. But next week, we're going to talk a little bit about 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and the Antichrist in that passage of scripture. And I think we're going to find some interesting information. But one of the things that I did with the marriage, one of the main ideas was I wanted to introduce the concept of the week, the 7-year tribulation thought. Okay, and that much archaeology and even Samson's wedding feast and Jacob, whenever he had a wedding feast for Leah, those both lasted a week long, so 7 days. And many times in prophetic literature, a 7-day period can represent a 7-year period, just like Daniel's prophecy, which we spent about 3 weeks on that, if you've been with us. And that's a lot of information. Some of it's kind of complicated. I think many of you would probably agree, but we did the best we could, and we repeated it multiple times, that there was the angel Gabriel showed up to Daniel, and he told him, he said that there are 70 weeks determined upon your people. And there was some certain stipulations that had to take place. And when you do the math, there's no way it could have just been 70 weeks. And really and truly, it was prophetically talking about 70 times 7, which was 70 years times 7 different times. So what ended up happening was that's 490 years. And what we spoke of, it said that from the going forth to rebuild the city until Messiah was going to be 69 of those 70 weeks. I'm kind of breaking it down a little bit more simple for you right here. 69 of those 70 weeks, which is 483 years. And whenever you look at the book of Nehemiah, which we happened to preach beforehand, we didn't plan all this out, but the Lord was doing it for us, that we preached on Nehemiah and the rebuilding of the walls. Whenever the king spoke and said, okay, Nehemiah, the cupbearer, you can go back and you can start building those walls. People say that the scholars say that was 444 BC. When you do the math, okay, to the day that Jesus showed up on the triumphant entry, and you take the Gregorian calendar and the Hebrew calendar, it comes out to exactly that. It was 483 years. So Jesus showed from the time that Nehemiah gave the proclamation to rebuild the walls of the city until Jesus showed up at the triumphant entry was exactly 483 years. And so there was a 7-year period that was left to equal up that last 70 week, which is 490 years. And so what we talked about, though, in the Daniel prophecy was that there was going to be a prince of the people, a prince that was going to come of the people, and it spoke of the Roman Empire, and that the people were going to destroy. The reason we know it was the Roman Empire was because those people were going to destroy the city and the sanctuary, and it was the Roman Empire under Titus in AD 70 that did that very thing. But the prince that is to come, it said, would come from those people. But see, the Antichrist, he hasn't come yet, but he's going to come. And when he does, he's going to come forth from a revitalized Roman Empire. All right, now we'll explain a little bit of that tonight. We probably won't get into it too deep. I did explain it last week, but I'll probably repeat it. I like to repeat some of these things so that if nothing else, it'll be at least in our heart and in our mind at some point, we'll be able to think more about it. Amen. I don't know about you, but I need things repeated for me. But so what happened, though, was that we introduced the concept of the Antichrist. And I think it's important that we understand this. And let me tell you why. Some people think you're not even going to see him. I'm not so positive about that. As a matter of fact, my contention is, and listen, we don't have to agree on everything. Can we all say that? Is that okay? Can you shake your head for me? Like, in other words, if you think I'm preaching heresy, I want you to come up here and talk to me after. All right? I mean, if you're bold enough to raise your hand and start shouting me down, that's fine too. I mean, we'll deal with it as it comes. But you know, nevertheless, what I want you to know is that we may not agree on every specific detail. But if we're brothers and sisters in the Lord, this is how I'm looking at it, man. This is what the Lord told me. Present my word for the way it's written. That's it. Open it up. Learn how to study my scriptures. Don't be influenced. Listen, there's some men that I follow behind, that I read behind, Greek scholars and other mighty men of God, people that I've sat under their preaching, people that I've respected. But listen, the Bereans were more noble than those in Thessalonica. Why? Because the book of Acts said, whenever Paul preached to the Bereans, what did they do? They went home and they studied the scriptures for themselves. They did not just take what a man told them. And we're talking about the mighty apostle Paul. And if you got to go home and study what Paul preaches to you, you better know you need to go home and study what I preach to you. And whenever I listen to other men preach, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to go home and study, amen, to show myself approved. Amen. Hallelujah. That's what we got to do.
Thank you, Lord.
So anyway, one of the things, though, that I wanted to point out, all that was a rabbit trail. What I wanted to say was this, is that the initiating event in my mind is not as much the rapture of the church that starts the 7-year tribulation. Now, I'm not going to turn to it, but I'll tell you where it is. It's in Daniel chapter 9, and it's in the last portion of Daniel chapter 9, starting, I think, in verse 27. And what it does is that it chronicles through, it goes through this prophecy, and it tells you that the last week right there, it actually starts in verse 24 and it goes all the way through 27. Daniel 9, 24 through 27. Some of y'all got my phone number, you got some Facebook. Go ahead, send me a message, we'll talk about it. Amen. Hey, look, the sister over there, I'm not going to call her name out, but she called me about that passage, right? We talked about that like 2 months before we ever preached it. So this is my point to all that. This initiating event appears to me to be when he confirms a covenant with many for a week. So when the covenant is signed, did you know that the Vatican signed a covenant or signed a treaty with Palestine and recognized them as a two-state system? You know, this doesn't have anything to do with it other than the fact it does have a lot to do with end-time events. Whenever I did a teaching on occult exposure, and I'm probably going to do that too once we get our TVs up, because we're in the midst of all this revelation stuff, and I think we're going to do that. because it connects all the modern stuff to everything that's going on. Did you know that, you probably didn't know this, but the Vatican signed two concordats. They signed one with Italy and they signed one with Germany before World War II ever broke out. And what it did was it influenced the people to stand behind Hitler before they really knew who and what he was. There's a whole lot more to that story, but we don't have time to open up that can of worms. What I'm trying to tell you is this, is that, and I know people don't even know, you got pictures of them shaking Hitler's hand, the Pope and Hitler shaking hands. You're not supposed to say all that kind of stuff, right? Well, I'm sorry. I'm just telling you, all you got to do, get your phone out right now. I'll give you permission if you want to and Google it. Pictures of the Pope with Hitler. Yes, ma'am.
Are you Pope? He was Hitler Youth.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, and the one before him, too. That is, you taking notes? If you're taking notes, write that down, because I want you to see it with your own eyes. People think that you're being mean when you do this stuff. This isn't being mean. This is what you call making people aware. You can do what you want with this, but the fact of the matter is that there's not only going to be an antichrist, there's also going to be a false prophet. And I'm just letting you know that there's millions and billions of people that are deceived. So the thing that I wanted you to do was, I wanted you to go ahead and write now so you can go Google it for yourself later. The last pope, I don't remember what his real name was, but they called him Benedict. Could Google Benedict and the Hitler Youth. And she's saying the same one thing for the one right now. You go ahead and Google it. I saw the picture of the last one. It was right there. He had his little Nazi uniform on. Something's not right with that picture. You can also connect Republican politicians that have been in the past. I'm not going to bring up their name right now. I mean, I've done it before. I'm not scared to. And when we teach it, I'll do it again. My point is that it's a mess out there, dude. And we're going to get into it a little bit tonight on why some of that's going on. All right. But what we did was we talked about this man, this prince that was to come, and that he was going to confirm a covenant with many for a week. And in the middle of the week, he was going to break the covenant. And that he was going to elevate himself. And that's what Jesus was talking about. Jesus talked about in Matthew 24, the abomination that causes desolation. He's going to set himself up, according to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, in the temple. And he's going to want himself to be exalted as God. Okay? And so that's where we got off on the Antichrist. And so last week we talked about a couple of things about the Antichrist. We talked about the fact that he's going to be given a mouth. So the beast system, let me go ahead and just take a little bit of time with this. The beast system is, and listen, once again, this may be something that if you read behind somebody else, they may see it a little bit differently. It's okay. We don't have to get all nervous. You don't have to take everything that I tell you as, I'm not Jesus. I'm not the Holy Spirit, but I sure dig in there and I'm looking for the truth, okay? So listen, it's okay if we don't agree on every single thing. But this is what the Lord is showing me. Whenever we talk about the beast or the beast system, all right, it talks about in Revelation chapter 17 a seven-headed beast, does it not? Yeah. Seven heads. And on this seven-headed beast, we're told at some point in time in the story of Revelation chapter 17 that there's a connection between the beast and a harlot. Remember that? See, not only is there a story of a marriage with a bride, amen, and a bridegroom, but there's also a story of a harlot that's in the midst of the story that's trying to bring the ruination to the marriage that the father has. And this harlot is causing deception, and she represents false religion. And it can be any false religion upon the earth. We don't have to get into the fact that she's dressed, arrayed in purple and scarlet, and that she's decked out with jewels. We won't even go there tonight. I've gone there enough times. But what I will tell you is that she doesn't represent just one entity that we see with our eyes upon the scene. Instead, she represents every aspect of mystery religion, starting back at the Tower of Babel, Genesis chapter 11, and Nimrod, and we'll get into him next week. And mystery religions have been spread and have been initiated throughout the earth all of these thousands of years of human history, and the whole purpose is to cause blindness. The Word of God says in Revelation 17 that she is drunk with the blood of the saints, the martyrs, but not only that the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. False religion has made humanity drunk. And I'm not just talking about Buddhism and Sufism and Taoism and all these and Confucianism. I'm talking about the modern church. I'm talking about preachers standing behind a pulpit, preaching a gospel that isn't the truth, preaching a works-based message, preaching something that doesn't point people to the truth of Jesus Christ, that Him crucified and that His sacrifice is the only access to grace in order to empower a man to live a life that that brings God glory upon this earth, if you're not preaching that, then you're putting people in blindness. You're causing scales to be placed upon their eyes. And let me tell you something else. They got preachers standing behind pulpits that are following the lies of Rick Warren and following the lies of all these other people. Listen to me. He's over there shaking hands with the Pope. What's going on, people? No, you gotta get your eyes open. You gotta wake up. You need to know who's teaching you. You need to know who you're sitting under. And you need to know whether or not people are digging into the Word of the living God and feeding you the true manna, amen, which is Jesus. And if they're not giving you that, you're in the wrong place.
Amen.
All right, seven heads. And these seven heads represent seven hills. We're not even going to get into that. I will tell you that Rome is built on seven hills, but that's just another story for another time. Seven heads, seven hills, seven kings, representing seven kingdoms. And in these kingdoms, what I told you last week, and this is all part of it, because really if I was going to title tonight's message, I was going to try to preach on two different things, but there's no way I'll have time. So the first thing we're going to talk about is the Antichrist and his power. And I want to talk to you about that a little bit, but I want to give you an idea of some things here. So these seven kingdoms, I'm going to tell you that this is what I believe, okay? Egypt is number one. Now, the interesting thing about all of these kingdoms that represent these heads is this, is that each one of these countries or nations or kingdoms that I'm going to talk to you about, in some way, shape, or form, through the thousands of years of human history, were used by the enemy to purposefully try to hold God's people Israel down. And just as in the last days, that's going to be the same plan. Amen. You understand that salvation history, that's a good word to write down right there if you're taking notes. Salvation history. Salvation, his story. See, man chronicles history through wars and weather, whether it be earthquakes and forest fires and mudslides and war and all these other things, the falling and rising of empires. God chronicles history through salvation. And he wrote it right here in his book. And the way that he chronicled salvation was, he called a man named Abraham out from Babylon, Ur of the Chaldees. Come out of your father's house and I will make you a nation. And I will bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you. And through your seed, all nations of the earth shall be blessed. Amen. We were given Isaac through Abraham. Through Isaac we were given Jacob and Esau. Through Jacob we were given the 12 tribes. The 12 tribes in Egypt as slaves swelled to a great nation on the Passover night. Hallelujah. With a beautiful picture of the cross. They're delivered out on dry ground. And then finally when they settle into the land of Canaan that God had promised them, which is modern day Israel, that they're trying to rename Palestine. And the point is that God had created for himself his own nation. And then on that glorious day, the angel showed up and told Mary, you're highly beloved amongst women. Highly favored amongst women. You're going to be with child. Hallelujah, the Messiah. Oh, we talked about Messiah last week. If you weren't here, you missed it. It's not, Christ isn't his last name. It's his title. It means anointed. Messiah means anointed. Christ means anointed. He was the anointed one. He's the one that the prophets spoke of for thousands of years. He was manifest. He was born of the Virgin. He came from the Father. He was the one that was without sin. He had to be without sin because man was created without sin. And then man took sin into himself. And Adam, as the fountainhead of all humanity, caused sin to spread throughout the entirety of the human race. But then Jesus came, incarnated in the flesh. Hallelujah. Sinless flesh. And offered that sinless flesh, that sinless life on the cross and paid the penalty of your sin. And now when you believe in that, oh, hallelujah. When you believe in that, something happens. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, I put the Holy Spirit on that. So something happens. God's creating a new people. Oh, a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. Hallelujah. You're a chosen people who should show forth the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Amen.
Yes,
right, listen, so God created a nation called Israel out of one man. Through Israel, he gave us Jesus. And in Jesus, he's creating an eternal family. You see that?
Thank you.
Well, there's a harlot in the story. And the harlot wants to stop the marriage at all costs. This isn't about 10 steps to your better life tomorrow. This isn't about finding the champion in you, because if you have Jesus in you, then you don't have a champion in you.
Yes.
That's New Age garbage.
Yes.
We need the blood.
Yes.
The blood, the victory's in the blood.
Yes.
He destroyed the power of sin at the cross.
Yes.
Colossians 2:14 and 15. He's triumphed over them. Who's them? The forces of evil. He triumphed over them in it. What is it? Go back to the scripture. The cross.
Hallelujah.
Through the giving of his sinless life, he triumphed over the forces of evil. We need the cross and the message of the blood and more now than ever before.
Yes.
As we open up today's teaching, if I ever get to it, you're going to see what I'm trying to tell you. Now listen, there are kingdoms, and these kingdoms have been run by wicked men. And these wicked men have allowed themselves to be used as vessels, just as you, each and every one of you in this place, like I said when I was praying, were formed out of clay, and God breathed life into Adam. And now when you give your life to Christ, he allows you to be filled up with the Holy Spirit. He uses you as a vessel, and you're walking around this earth, and you're supposed to be letting your light shine upon you. Hallelujah! Let your light shine on this before you're in a war.
Yeah.
People's souls hang in the balance. And we over here being told all this other stuff. Come on, somebody. Am I telling you the truth?
Amen.
I know it's not good for your reputation, preacher, but I don't really care about that.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Egypt was one. Assyria took the northern kingdom in about 726 B.C. The northern kingdom being the 10 northern tribes, the 2 southern tribes being Benjamin and Judah, right? Number 3, Babylon. King Nebuchadnezzar took Daniel and Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego, the Hebrew boys. Remember that? We talked about that. We preached on that.
Yeah.
All right. Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Medo-Persia. A two-kingdom enterprise that Daniel really delineated between the two, because in one of his prophecies there was a bear that lifted himself up on one side that represented this country, and then in the other one there was a ram that had two horns, and one of the horns was taller than the other, because towards the end Persia overwhelmed the Medes and became more powerful. All right, number 5, Alexander the Great and Greece. See, Daniel prophesied all this stuff before it ever happened. Well, these had already happened. These two had happened. He was a young boy whenever that one happened, and when he prophesied this was going on. But he prophesied this right here before it ever happened. And then he talked about another kingdom that had iron teeth and stamped the residue of all the previous three. He just talked about these right here. That was the Roman Empire. And what he talked about in that Roman Empire had to do with the fact that it had 10 horns. That's how we connect it back to the Roman Empire, or a revitalized Roman Empire, because of the 10 horns, because that never happened yet, and it says it in the book of Revelation. It says that this seven-headed beast in the book of Revelation has 7 heads and 10 horns. So that's a revitalized Roman Empire. Now, this is my interpretation of it, is that this is actually number 7. I'm sorry, did I miss one? Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, Rome. 10 horns is number 7, and then the 8th comes from the 7th. I believe that's Antichrist, his empire. It says that these kings give him power for a certain period of time. So it says number 8 comes from them. So that's the Antichrist kingdom right there. All right. So what I did, I put a few pictures up here. I wanted to make a point, and I didn't know if really I should do this, because it's really kind of technical and it's kind of deep, but I like doing that kind of stuff. And so I tried to put some pictures up here so that we could talk about it. You know, for the longest time, the reason I wanted to do this was because I was very untrained in the scriptures. I got saved when I was 19. I'm not going to get into all that story, but y'all know I was a mess. Drugs, alcohol had dominated my life. And I got saved, and for 12 years, I really didn't know the Bible like I should. And anyway, you know, when the Lord opened up my eyes and allowed me to start seeing some things, I was really amazed. First off, he gave me a foundation of the finished work of Christ, and without that, I'd be lost. Amen. But then he started opening up my eyes to all these end time things and things that were going on in the world today. And I started realizing the Lord said, now you see why the cross is so important. Because you need to understand where your victory comes from. Because you are in a true battle, child of God, soldier.
Yes.
You're in a battle.
Yes.
But one of the things, my misconception was that because the beast system, so let's get that clear. I don't think I made myself clear. So the beast is a system of these nations. In my book I wrote, I pretended as though there was like a vision when I tried to describe this. I know I told y'all this last week, but I think it gives you a good visual. Where this beast is galloping almost like on a timeline. 2000 BC, 1500 BC, 1000 BC, 586 BC, 33 AD, modern day. And this whole time this beast has been galloping and this harlot's riding its back and she's drinking the blood of the saints and she's laughing and everybody's deceived and they're walking around drunk and this thing's just like, poof, poof, coming through the ages. And it's these kingdoms that have joined themselves. As a matter of fact, let me go ahead and turn there real quick. Psalm chapter 2. Just so that you can kind of get a little bit of a picture. I know I quote it to you a lot, but let's go ahead and turn there. Psalm chapter 2. I think I'm going to preach on that pretty soon. It says, "Why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth," that's the same thing we're talking about with this beast system, "the kings of the earth set themselves." If you've ever played football, that's the picture I get here. In football, you had to get down in a stance. It was either a three-point stance or a four-point stance. The kings of the earth set themselves. It's almost like a linebacker. You can see that? They're setting themselves. They're getting themselves prepared, is what it's talking about. They set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together. And who do they do that with? Against the Lord and against His anointed. Now, if you understand who the anointed is, because we talked about that, the Christ, the Messiah, it's talking about the Father, and it's talking about the Son, ultimately, that would come. Then the psalm is written 1,000 years before Jesus ever showed up. So this is speaking prophetically, okay? That the kings of the earth and the rulers are coming together and they're taking counsel against the Lord and His anointed, or the promised one, which was Jesus. And he goes on to say, "Let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. He that sits in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. Then shall He speak unto them in His wrath and vex them in His sore displeasure. Yet have I set my king upon my holy hill of Zion." That's talking about Zion is one of the mountains in Jerusalem. And ultimately, Jesus will rule and reign from Jerusalem during the millennial reign of Christ. "I will declare the decree the Lord has said unto me. You are my son, this day have I begotten thee." That's talking about the incarnation of Jesus. "Ask of me, and I shall give thee the heathen for thine inheritance, and the uttermost parts of the earth for thy possession." He's talking about all these nations that have raged against God through all these millennia and all of this time, that the Son, amen, the King that will rule from Zion, is ultimately going to have these heathen as His possession. One day they're going to come to Jerusalem and they're going to pay homage to Him, amen, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He says, goes on to say, "You shall break them with a rod of iron. You shall dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Be wise now, therefore, O you kings. Be instructed, you judges of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest He be angry and you perish from the way when His wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are all they that put their trust in Him." So, what I wanted to point out with that was this. Was that I used to have the misconception that because the book of Revelation was at the end and the beast shows up at the end, that it just all shows up at the end. You understand what I'm saying? Oh, we're all good. We're just whistling around, playing games. Everything's good, man. Look how blue the sky is. And the clouds look so fluffy. And look, oh, the flowers, they smell so good. And everything's just hunky-dory. And the beast doesn't show up to the end. And one of the things that I realize now is, no, He's been here from the beginning. He was there in the garden. And He keeps on showing up and He keeps on repackaging Himself. You understand that? And so part of what I wanted to talk to you about tonight regarding the power, and this may seem like it's a little off course a little bit, but you see this picture has to do with different types of manuscripts. And what you call this is, I just wanted you to be able to get a little bit of a picture. I think I might have... There you go. There's a manuscript fragment right there. So this is kind of what it looks like when archaeologists find the Bible. So they're over here digging around in pottery and whatever the case is. This is what the Bible looks like when they find it. But, you know, but they found thousands of them, right? And so, like, this piece might be missing something, but they had another piece that was whole. And so, you understand? So they're comparing and they're contrasting and they're putting pieces of it together. And it's very meticulous and it's a very tedious process. But I wanted you to understand a couple of things because I'm about to give you a kind of a big concept. But, you know, they say that what Paul would have written on would have been called the autograph, okay? It's important that you learn everything that you can about the Bible, in my opinion. Because you see, one day you might talk to somebody that knows a whole lot more than you do, and he'll try to interject doubt in your mind. Whenever you come to this church, the Lord said, we're to make disciples. A disciple is a learner of Christ. My opinion on what discipleship is and what some other people consider discipleship is two completely different things. I'm not trying to tell you that I'm right. I'm just trying to tell you that I believe that we're supposed to learn the Bible. Amen? And we're supposed to know as much about it as what we can.
Amen.
All right. People have, I will say this, and it's not because I'm bitter. I'm just telling you the truth. People have told me in the past, you teach too deep and people don't understand. That's because we don't teach them. You're supposed to teach people the Bible. And you know what? People have a capacity to learn. And if you don't know a word, you get a dictionary and you learn the word and you take notes and you study the word. And that's how you learn, right? We already talked about that. If you want to be a good electrician, you got to know conduits and different kinds of connections. You get my point. All right. So an autograph is what Paul wrote on. A manuscript is what the copyist copied. And they copied thousands of copies. Amen? And they would copy them over and over again. And so they're found archaeologically. And so from the manuscript is where we get a translation. And there's a lot of different types of translations, but listen to me now. Let's be careful, because I don't want to say something and you take me the wrong way and you think I'm a heretic. A translation is only as much the Word of God as close as it is to the original that was written. The original that was... No, it is the Word of God. This is the Word of God. This King James Bible right here is the Word of God. Amen? But what I want you to know is that what was inspired was whenever the Holy Spirit... Theopneustos, God breathed into Paul, through Paul, upon the papyrus, amen, and as discussed, because listen, it's been proven that there's been multiple manuscript fragments that where one letter was off, one word was off. It doesn't change anything, but they were able to prove all of that. The scribes that copied these things weren't inspired. I mean, God used them greatly. God protected the Word of God. The enemy of our soul will never destroy this Word.
Amen.
Amen. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the Word of the Lord, it will remain forever. And God's been taking care of this book like it's his precious baby. Amen. And so I wanted you to just see and get a little bit of a concept behind this, because I'm about to hit you with kind of a big thought here in a moment. All right. You ever heard of this word right here, Septuagint? It was about 300 B.C. Have y'all ever heard of that before? It's a let me go ahead and see if I can. It was a Greek translation of the Hebrew Old Testament, and it was used during the time frame of Paul and also during the time frame of Jesus. You remember how I told you before? Y'all remember? I know people that come to this church. You've heard me saying this a million times. Hellenism. Y'all remember that word? Okay, if you remember, tell me what it is. No, just joking. Hellenism is the spread of the Greek culture upon the civilization of the time. When Alexander the Great conquered the known world of that time, Hellenism describes the fact that he brought his language and his culture, and it infiltrated the modern society. All right? And so, at the time frame that the Jews lived in Rome, this is a fancy word, lingua franca, but it means the language that was used. Like in America, for the most part, the language that's used is English right now. The language that was used in Rome at the time was Greek. Many of the Jews, as they were being born into families and generations were passing, could not speak or read Hebrew. Does that make sense? Because they learned Greek. So therefore, in order for their children to be able to understand the Old Testament scriptures, they had to come up with a translation. Just like this is in English, the King James Bible. As a matter of fact, if you don't have a King James Bible with you, we got a stack of them back there, because in a minute I don't have it on the screen and we're going to be turning in the book. Okay, so I just want you to know if you need one, they're back there. This is a translation, though. This is an English translation. There's Chinese translations. There's Vietnamese translations. It goes from the original language into the receptor language so that the people can receive the word, amen, and allow the word of God to come into their hearts. I'm a King James man. And the reason why, I'm going to tell you why, it has to do with manuscripts, okay? And I'm going to go ahead and just write this on the board, and if you want to take notes on it, you can. It's called A Lamp in the Dark. And this will tell you why I'm a King James man. It's not because I'm just some old dude that doesn't know anything. I'm not really that old. It's called A Lamp in the Dark. And it's actually got part one and two. Now just bear with me, because we're going to be here for a long time. I cut out half of the message. A Lamp in the Dark, part one and part two. It's about 6 hours worth of teaching. It chronicles the history of the Bible. It chronicles how the King James Version came about, and it chronicles the persecution from the Catholic Church upon the Protestants that were trying to produce this document, and the countless lives that were lost, and the volume of blood that was spilled in the midst of this process, people being burned at the stake. All right, and so I want, and you know, I don't have time to get into all the different manuscript thoughts behind it, but the newer translations use what you call an eclectic text, meaning they found other manuscripts, and some of those manuscripts, one of them was called the Sinaiticus, and one of them was called the Vaticanus. And Erasmus, who came up with the one for the King James, he said, we wouldn't use that. We're not going to use that. And because it had some faulty stuff in it, okay? Nevertheless, that's my main thing there. All right, so you understand the concept between the Septuagint. Now, what I wanted you to see was this. Actually, if you have your Bible, let's turn real quick to Genesis chapter 10. We're still talking about the power of the Antichrist, and we're also talking about the spirit of Antichrist that has been on the land. Does that make sense? Just as the Holy Spirit is moving on your heart to give your life to Jesus, the spirit of Antichrist has been moving on people's hearts to fall in order with him and also to drive people away from Jesus, all right? In Genesis chapter 10, verse 32, it says, these are the families of the sons of Noah after their generations in their nations, and by these were the nations divided in the earth after the flood. Now, if you count how many names there are there, this is called by scholars the Table of Nations. All right, I'm going somewhere. I'm just trying to develop it slowly so that we're kind of all on the same page. Table of Nations, 70 nations, 70 offspring from Noah, his original three boys, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. If you read 70 offspring, 70 nations, this was after the flood. We know the story, though. What happened was that under the leadership of Nimrod, who we'll mention next week, he was one of the offspring that was born here. He said he rebelled against God. He said, come, let us build ourselves a city. Let us make bricks. And let us build ourselves a tower that extends into the heavens. See, they wanted to build a tower that would go to the heavens, where the Word of God says in the end of Revelation, God wants to bring a city to man. They're trying to bring a city up to God. But the reality of it is that I have discovered that the reason that God confused their languages was because they were doing satanic worship. It's real easy. You see these pyramids and these ziggurat structures all over the world. There's one in Guatemala, and I've told y'all this before, where there were 50,000 skeletal remains found. This is all having to do with occult worship. That's how they were going to extend themselves into the heavens. I used to be so confused about that. I used to think, God, why are you so worried about them building the towers made out of brick? Come on. You never got mad at the people for building the Empire State Building. When they built that, you didn't get mad at them for that. And now I realize, no, they were accessing spiritual entity, and they were coming together as a one world order. A one world order, a one world religion, a one world government under the leadership of Nimrod, and Nimrod right under the liar. And since that day, the enemy of our soul has been in the process of bringing humanity back to a new world order. I mean, listen, Google that right there. Why don't you Google? You got your pen out? Go ahead, take your note. I said I wasn't going to call him out, but I am. George Bush Sr. Speech on the New World Order. George Bush Sr.'s speech on the New World Order, and you look at the date. See, that's what's going to really get you. Look at the date that he gave that speech. Exactly 11 years to the day before 9/11. Ooh, I don't know. That's just something weird about that. Especially whenever you study a little bit about the history of the occult and you find out that the number of 11 is a number that stands for deep, dark magic. September 11th, exactly 11 years before 9/11, George Bush Sr., you're not supposed to say that on video, huh? George Bush Sr. gave a speech where he said, a new world order will rise in the midst of chaos. So what I'm trying to tell you is this, is that the kings of the earth have set themselves, rulers have taken counsel together against the Lord and his anointed. They've thrown in like Nimrod, they're along with the liar, and have attempted to bring humanity in a certain direction, and everything that they try to do was to bring humanity away from God and his plan. Right here, what we're talking about is the 70 nations that were listed or named after the sons of Noah, if you will, and then the Tower of Babel. Once the confusion of the languages, everybody began to spread across the globe. All right. Now, what I want to show you though is this. This is the Septuagint. I got it in my phone. What I did was I copied and pasted it out of my phone. This is Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 8. Now, do you have your Bible? Because if you have your Bible, I want you to turn to Deuteronomy 32, verse 8 in your Bible. Now, does anybody have an ESV Bible? It's okay. You can raise your hand. I'm not going to pick on you. If you have an ESV Bible, it's going to be different. That's why I'm asking you. It's going to be different than the King James. So Deuteronomy is the fifth book of the Old Testament. Deuteronomy 32, verse 8. Now, in the King James Version, it says in verse 8 of Deuteronomy 32, when the Most High divided the nations, their inheritance, when he separated the sons of Adam, he set the bounds of the people according to the number of the children of Israel. Now, first off, to be more specific, the children of Israel weren't even in existence whenever the nations were divided because they weren't a nation yet. Okay, but I'm not trying to come against that. I'm trying to make a point for this. The Septuagint. Scholars will agree to you. Now, this is not my old pastor almost had everybody. We went to a flying conference a bunch of scholars, and he asked a question. He said, "I don't mean to be ugly, but isn't this a translation too?" And look, you could have heard a pin drop. But that's what it is. It's a translation because it wasn't the original writing. Amen. But it's a translation. But it's an important translation, and scholars use it, and people respect this. Jesus would have read from this, probably. Paul definitely read from this. But look what it says in Deuteronomy 32:8. It says, divided up by the children of Israel. Look at this word right here. This word right here in the Greek, I can tell you, I've studied enough to know, it's angelon. It's the word for angel. So this is the Greek language. It's the Old Testament. It says that they were divided according to the angels of God, is what it says in the Septuagint. Okay, now let's look at, now I want to show you this other, because this is the ESV, because see what ended up happening was that they found the Dead Sea Scrolls. Y'all heard that story where that little boy was throwing rocks in caves and he heard the little pottery breaking and they went in there and they found the Dead Sea Scrolls and had multiple Old Testament passages. So this is the King James Version, according to the number of the children. Now look at this. In the ESV, it says, according to the number of the sons of God. Now, any of you that have studied with us should remember what the terminology sons of God represents. The terminology sons of God, you can find that in, well, let's go ahead and turn to it, just so that we're being thorough. Genesis chapter 6. I took a long time to make this point, but this is kind of stuff that it interests me, and I hope that it's interesting to you too. So let's look right here. Genesis chapter 6, it says, and it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men which were of old, men of renown. So I have to tell you that this is at least PG-13 stuff right here. But, you know, what's basically being said here is the sons of God is the same terminology as the angels that came into the daughters of men. I know that kind of blows people away and they don't really know what to do with that. I'm just telling you what the Bible says. It also says it in Job chapter 1. This is how we know it's talking about angels, because in Job chapter 1, it says in verse 6 of Job chapter 1, I'll just read it to you. It says it right here. Now, there was a day, but you know what? I think I can actually do something more here. I can let you see it. Job chapter 1, verse 6, and it says it right here. It says, now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. So you don't think that this is just some You know, some scholars tried to say that these were the descendants of Cain in Genesis 6. But my question always was, well, why does a descendant of Cain cohabiting with a daughter of man produce a giant in the land? But nevertheless, that's what's going on here. Now this isn't just two scriptures to prove this. Multiple New Testament scriptures bear this out when you get into the original language. I know that this is new information. I'm not ashamed to tell you about it. To be honest with you, I'm real happy that I'm confident enough to tell the whole group what's going on in the Bible so that you would understand. You see, the enemy of our soul, you got to understand, in the garden, God made a proclamation. He told the serpent, the seed of the woman is going to crush your head. He was ultimately talking about Jesus, and immediately the enemy attempted to thwart the plan of God by, oh, here we go. I'm having issues with my phone. Technology. The enemy of God attempted to thwart the plan of God, and the way that he did that was by intermixing and trying to no longer that it would be the seed of the woman, but that instead it would be a hybrid race. Does that make sense? A mixture. The Bible says that there were angels in the land. As a matter of fact, if you're taking notes, I have a 3-part series on YouTube called Did Jesus Go to Hell? And basically it ended up being a whole teaching on the Nephilim, the giants. And I mean, we got into detail. I mean, you would be blown away all the places in the Bible in the Old Testament that the children of Israel had to deal with this stuff. And we took it from square one and we worked our way through. And the reason that it's important for you to understand that today is that the modern day occultist, like Aleister Crowley, who Ozzy Osbourne wrote the song about. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. I know that it was popular when I was in high school in Houston in the 80s, and I know it's in Guitar Hero. He taught people through the occult arts how to access the spirits of the old ones. And many people believe that that demon spirits that are on the earth are the released spirits that come, or at least part of it, are the released spirit from these Nephilim, these giants that were on the land. And that they can invoke them through their satanic ritual. And just as you as a child of God get born again and you get filled up with the Holy Spirit, these people invoke these things to take over. That's why whenever you watch Beyonce, Good Fight Ministries has a good video on that. Beyonce Occult Ritual Super Bowl. If you Google that, you'll get it. Beyonce Occult Ritual Super Bowl. She starts doing all these little hand signals. All of a sudden, you see her whole face change. She says on the video, whenever somebody's interviewing, that's not even me. That girl, that's Sasha Fierce. She shows up. She takes over. I can't even act like that. And this thing, and they're channeling. You don't have to believe it if you don't want to. I've already had people leave the church because of that. Go on. I mean, I don't mean to be ugly. If you watch the video, you're going to find out one day. You're going to say, you know what? I liked you, Matt, because you tried to tell me the truth. You weren't so worried about me showing up throwing money in the basket. You told me the truth. And listen to me. I go preach to them at the jail, and they're like, oh, man, I'm ready to give my heart to the Lord. Well, you're going to go home first off. You say you ain't going to smoke no dope. What you're going to do is you're going to find a honey to lay with, number one. And then number two, you're going to go start filling yourself up with all that music again. You're going to let that beat get all up in there. And then here's old Snoop Dogg sitting on the chair with the video saying, can I still be a G after I give my heart to thee? And he ain't talking about Jesus. He's talking about the liar. And these people are selling their soul out for this stuff. And they're the preachers of Satan's gospel. They over there telling people, fill yourself with flesh. Fill yourself with sex. Fill yourself with drugs. Come on. Feed the flesh. Live for the flesh. And everybody's over here getting drunk. And they're getting all filled up. And they what are they? They're drunk with the wine of her fornication. Yes. The inhabitants of the earth are drunk with the wine of her fornication. I'm just going through my daily life. Oh, preacher, I don't like it. You talk about secular music. Yeah, you didn't know the preacher was going to give you a reason to talk about secular music, did you? Uh-huh. You just thought he was going to preach a bunch of law to you. No, I'm telling you, there's demon spirits behind it.
Amen.
And you're feeding your spirit with demon spirits. And you want to know why you can't get free? Oh, Lord, set me free. Go, let me drink some more demon spirit.
Uh-huh.
Don't work that way, bro. Woo. You got to let the Lord separate you from that stuff.
Amen.
Amen.
Lord, help us. I know I used to do it. All right. So you understand what I'm saying? So what we're talking about now is the sons of God. So is it possible that just as God in the physical realm separated the nations through the descendants of Noah in the physical realm, that in the spiritual realm, he allowed fallen angels to have control over the various nations that exist on the earth. Oh, preacher, you're going to have to give me some scripture for that. Good, I'm glad you asked. So here we go. Right here, if we can get the thing to work. There we go. Daniel. So in this Daniel passage right here, Daniel had gone to the Lord in prayer. It's Daniel chapter 10. Sorry, I know my words are small. Daniel chapter 10, verses 12 through 13. And in Daniel chapter 10, verses 12 through 13, Daniel's praying to the Lord, but he hadn't gotten an answer to his prayer. And it says right here, "Then said he unto me, Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that you did set your heart to understand and to chasten thyself before thy God, thy words were heard, and I come for thy words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me." See, this is an angel telling Daniel this. "The prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days, but lo, Michael," one of the chief princes, talking about the archangel Michael, "came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia." So, the prince of Persia. So, even if I'm wrong on each one of these nations having a fallen angel over them, I'm not going to tell you that I'm definitely right on that, but I did give you a little evidence. I'm definitely telling you that the Word of God says that there's at least a prince of Persia. All right? Then, let's see, here we go. It says right here, "Then said he, Knowest thou wherefore I come unto thee, and now will I return to fight with the prince of Persia, and when I'm gone forth, lo, the prince of Grecia shall come." So not only is there a prince of Persia, but there's also a prince of Grecia. "But I will show thee that which is noted in the scripture of truth, and there is none that holdeth with me in these things but Michael your prince." So now this is interesting. So now we have a situation where God divided up the nations according to the sons of Noah. And we definitely see that there's demonic or angelic entities that sit over these pagan nations. But look at this. God created his own nation. You see, that's what happens right here. You got the flood. You got the Tower of Babel. You have the confusion of the languages and the people groups start to spread. The next chapter, what does God do? He calls Abraham out and he creates a nation out of him. And that nation, he gives them their own angel. And it's Michael, their prince. Amen? And so every other nation had... And see, whenever they worship these false gods, that's what they're worshiping. Fallen angels and demonic spirits. All these statues, Jupiter, Saturn, Astarte, all these, Ashtaroth, all of these are nothing but fallen angels repackaged in demonic spirits, and the people are worshiping them and they're pulling worship away from God. Well, let's look at Ephesians chapter 6 real quick. We're talking about the power of the Antichrist, and we're talking about the power of this wicked system. Ephesians chapter 6. Says, verse 10, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand the wiles of the devil." The word wiles is talking about trickery, deceit, cunning. "The devil roams around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour." Says, right there, though, it says, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood." Now in your own personal life, whenever that friend of yours does you dirty or that family member does you dirty, the first thing you want to do is you want to retaliate. I'm here to tell you that the faster you learn that you're not in a war against flesh and blood, but that instead the enemy's using other people in your life to come against you, the better off you're going to be.
Amen.
And we need to turn that over to the Lord. Amen.
Yes.
Lord, I can't fight this battle because if I fight, the Lord knows what's going to happen. I'm going to end up back in the clinker or something like that. I'll take somebody out, man. I get so angry and mad. You can't do that. You got to learn how to give it to the Lord. But on a grand scale, we got to understand that God's got something going on here too, and he wants us to engage it. He says that we war not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. That word principality is arche. Jesus, this word right here, remember when Jesus called Satan the prince of this world? He said it three times. He's the arche, chief ruler. Now, it wasn't intended to be that way. I mean, God wasn't taken by surprise. But what happened was that this earth was created for Adam. This earth was created for Adam, for him to have dominion over this earth. But when he went the way of the serpent, he relinquished his dominion. Now, ultimately, God is sovereign. Amen. I don't want you to get confused here. I'm not trying to tell you that the devil's in charge. No. God is in charge. He allows this thing to be played out that way. And he's given you and I a free will so that we would engage the battle, give our heart to Jesus, and through the power of the resurrected Lamb who was slain on Calvary's cross and defeated the power of sin through his power, filling us up, we now become soldiers, amen, in the midst of this fight. Amen. And so the chief rulers, so there's angels, we've already talked about that are in certain places. This word powers is exousia, and it literally means dominions. So just as some of them were over Greece, and some of them were over Persia, there's dominions over the music industry, dominions over Hollywood. I mean, we can go on and on down the list. There's dominions over churches. I know good and well, I got some dominions that want to try to get up in this place and try to ruin everything. So anyway, you get my point. Powers. Rulers of darkness. That word is cosmocrator, which means a world ruler. And literally, we'll talk about Satan for sure, and then I think there's some other angels that in a second we're going to get into one. I need to hustle up. And then lastly, it says right here, spiritual wickedness, which is talking about demon spirits. In the Greek, it's pneumaponeria, which means evil spirits. So it's talking about demon spirits. So you got angels of different classes. And you have demonic entities. And the Word of God says that you and I are at a war in this. The true child of God is, there's a real fight that's raging. Amen?
Yeah.
And the enemy wants to get our life so messed up that we don't have time to see the big picture.
Amen.
I'm talking to the preacher, man. The enemy wants to get us so consumed in everything going on around us that we don't see that soul that's hurting on the side of us. And don't realize that his soul hangs in the balance. Amen? All right. Let's go to Revelation chapter 13 real quick. Because I'm talking specifically, I wanted to talk specifically about the power of the Antichrist. Let's just go ahead and start reading. In chapter 13, and I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea having seven heads. I'd already talked to you about that. And 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority. See, that's power that's coming straight from Satan. You got to understand the Antichrist, ultimately, the beast is going to be a man. Because he's going to come from the revitalized Roman Empire, but then ultimately he's going to have a kingdom. And it says in Daniel and in the book of Revelation that he's given a mouth to speak and he's given the eyes of a man. Just as Jesus came in the flesh, the enemy of our soul is also going to possess the Antichrist. He's already possessed Judas, and he's also going to possess another man before it's over with. And he goes on to say, verse 3, and I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast. They worshiped the dragon which gave power unto the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? And there was given unto him a mouth, see there, speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months, that's 3.5 years. And he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle and them that dwell in heaven. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them, and power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations. All right, real quick, let's go to Revelation chapter 9. We're getting close. Revelation chapter 9, starting in verse 1. And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven. I saw a star fall from heaven, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. Now, this may get confusing to you, but I'm telling you right now, I don't have any question in my heart or mind that that's Satan right there. And it's kind of like, well, why would he be given a key to open up the bottomless pit? Well, before we move on, let's go ahead and think about that. Turn to me to Revelation chapter 6, verse 2. In Revelation 6, 2, it says, "And I saw and behold a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer." But look at verse 1. "I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard as it were the noise of thunder, and one of the four beasts saying, 'Come and see.'" Who opened the seal?
The Lamb.
The Lamb. Who's the Lamb?
Jesus.
Jesus opened the seal, but what happened? The first seal was opened, and what happened? A rider on a white horse, and he had a bow, but he didn't have arrows. I told you all this last week. I'm going to keep telling you because I wanted to get in your head. He comes with peace. He's got peace on his lips, but he's got other intents, and his intents are to conquer. And he comes riding on a white horse, and the real King of Kings and Lord of Lords is going to ride on a white horse in Revelation chapter 19, verse 13. He's clothed in a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen. But the first one that shows up is a counterfeit.
Yeah.
He's a counterfeit. He's the Antichrist.
Yeah.
And it says he's given a crown. Mm-hmm. That means he's allowed to have power. God is allowing. The Lamb opened the seal, and God's allowing him to have power. Well, why would God do that? Turn with me to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. If this doesn't wake you up and make you want to watch what kind of doctrine people are preaching to you, then nothing will. You'll stay asleep for the rest of your life. Lord, help us. And help this preacher not to sound so arrogant, because that's not what I want to sound like. But if you're not going to wake up, if we're not going to wake up, we're going to be in a bind, man. It says right here in 2 Thessalonians, I think I'm going to get him to cut that out. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. It says right here, "Even him," we're talking about the Antichrist, "whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders." He's going to perform miracles. You understand that? Pharaoh's magicians turned rods into serpents. He's going to be given authority to perform miracles to cause deception. In verse 10, "And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish." Why? "Because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved." So listen, if you think that everybody that sits in a church nowadays in these mega churches is saved, you are wrong. Amen. You can't get saved just by raising your hand in the back of a dark church one day. When a man is saved or a woman is saved, then the Word of God says that you believe with your heart and you confess with your mouth. The Word of God says when you get saved that the Holy Spirit comes to live on the inside of your heart. And according to Ephesians 1:13, you get sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. And when the Holy Spirit comes and lives in your heart, you can't just keep on living any old way that you used to be living. Come on now, you got to leave some part of the Holy Spirit dealing with you. Help us, Lord. And he goes on to say, "They receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved." Verse 11. "And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they might believe a lie." God's allowing all this to happen when it happens. The Lamb opens the seal. And listen, right now we're in Revelation 9. And it says, "And so an angel that fell was given a key to open up the bottomless pit." I don't have time to turn there, but Isaiah 14:12 talks about Lucifer. He was actually his name in the Hebrew right there is Hallel, and it's talking about a star in the morning. And it said that he fell. And Jesus said in Luke, he said, "I saw Satan fall like lightning to the earth." A star that fell. It says right here, "I saw a star fall from heaven and the earth, and to him a key was given to the bottomless pit." And he goes on to say, "And he opened up the bottomless pit, and there arose smoke out of the pit as the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given power, and scorpions of the earth." Scorpions of the earth have power. You know, Jesus said, as a matter of fact, I'm going to turn there real quick, Luke chapter 10. Those children's workers are going to be mad at me. That's all right. That's why we break it up. They don't have to do it every week, right? Just suck it up once a month. All right. It says right here in Luke chapter 10, he actually appointed 70 disciples. I thought that was interesting too. I didn't tell y'all that. 70 nations broken up from the sons of Noah. possibly 70 angels. I'm not trying to die on that mountain, so don't try to make me. But now 70 disciples. God uses clay, fills it up with his Holy Spirit. See, can you imagine an angel, how frustrating that must be for a fallen angel? I mean, think about that. Here he is, he's got all this magnificence, he's got all of this intelligence, he's got all of this power. And yet, one little old child of God, filled with the presence of God, putting his faith in the finished work of Christ, has more power and has authority over him and can tell him in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. You have no authority in my life.
Yes. Amen.
Now, you think that those things are frustrating. But this is what Jesus said in Luke chapter 10. He said, and the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject to unto us through your name. And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. And he said, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions. See, whenever that bottomless pit is opened up, these things look like scorpions. But Jesus beforehand wants you to know, before, I don't even think we're going to be here during that time, amen. But nevertheless, for those of you that are watching video that didn't want to listen, if you're here and you see some demon spirits that look like scorpions, just remember, Jesus gave you power to tread on scorpions. Hallelujah. Because the demon spirits don't have authority over you. And he goes on to say, power over the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Notwithstanding in this, rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. All right, now I'm back to Revelation chapter 9. And I'm just going to go ahead and fast forward a little bit because I do want to try to go ahead and wrap this up. Let's go to verse 6. And in those days shall men seek death. So these locusts are flying around now. They got the tail of a scorpion and they're stinging people. And in those days men shall seek death and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And the shapes of the locusts were like unto horses prepared unto battle, and on their heads were as it were crowns like gold, and their faces were as the faces of men, and they had hair as the hair of women, and their teeth were that like lions, and they had breastplates as it were breastplates of iron, and the sound of their wings was as the sound of chariots of many horses running to battle. Some people have tried to say, like, look at verse 10, and they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails, and their power was to hurt men 5 months. Some people used to try to say that these were helicopters. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, because in other words, John didn't know what he was seeing. But that can't be, because look at verse 11. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue, his name is Apollyon. And both of those words mean the great destroyer. Now, so the Lamb opens the seal. The Antichrist is given power. An angel that fell is given a key. He opens up the bottomless pit, and all this stuff is released. I mean, you want to talk, you think that the demon spirits are bad now. All this stuff is released upon the earth. The wrath of God has hit. Okay? And what I wanted to tell you real quick, I know I said I was going to quit, but one more scripture. So, some scholars try to say that Abaddon is Satan. I don't believe that, because Satan isn't in the bottomless pit yet. He won't be in the bottomless pit until during the millennial reign of Christ. He'll be locked up for 1,000 years. This is another angel. And listen to me. He ain't by himself. They got a bunch of them down there. And those are the ones that crossed boundaries in Genesis 6. Remember how we were talking about that? The sons of God came unto the daughters of men. Yeah. Multiple New Testament passages that show that they were reserved in chains of darkness until the day of judgment. And so there's not just this dude here, but there's multiple of them. And it says in the book of Jude, there's only one chapter, verse 6, and the angels which kept not their first estate, and I don't have time to break down the Greek to you, I've done it before, and it's actually in those three sermons that I did Jesus go to hell, but left their own habitation. They crossed boundaries. It really talks about the fact that they left their celestial body and they took upon themselves a form of a terrestrial body, and that they did whatever it was that they did. It says, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day. And let me tell you how I know that this is what they did. Look at this, verse 7. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah Now, what was the thing about the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah? You remember what they did over there? Oh, you're not supposed to talk about that, preacher. The Supreme Court just ruled that same-sex people can have marriage. I don't care what the Supreme Court said. They might put me in jail for that one day. I don't know. But you know what? Feed the family, because all I can tell you is that I didn't write it. The Word of God says it right here. Amen. And so they want me to keep my mouth shut. No, I'm not keeping my mouth shut. And then most of them people know anyway. Whenever you get saved and the Holy Spirit comes and lives in your heart, then He reveals to you, just like He revealed to me, I wasn't supposed to be looking at pornography. Just like He revealed to me, I wasn't supposed to be looking at the stuff I was looking at. I wasn't supposed to be sleeping around. PG-13. Now, y'all see worse stuff than that on TV. Come on now.
Yeah.
Y'all know good and well y'all do. It's much worse than that. I'm keeping it innocent. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah, but y'all know what they did, right? Even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication, look at this, and going after strange flesh. Don't tell me the New Testament doesn't have anything to say about it. They went after strange flesh. In the city, men were lying with men, but even in the story of Lot, it gets even more interesting because it was angels that showed up and the people of the city wanted to go lie with them. And this is what we're talking about, is angels up in this. And so that's what these angels did. Like the inhabitants of Sodom and Gomorrah, they went after strange flesh. Men with men, angels with the daughters of men, and they were reserved in chains of everlasting darkness until the day of judgment. And on that day, John said, I saw a star fall from heaven, and unto him was given a key, and he unlocked the bottomless pit. And all of these locusts, these demon spirits, were released, and they had an angel over them. The angel of the bottomless pit, his name was Abaddon, or Apollyon in the Greek, and it means great destroyer. All this stuff's going to be released upon the earth at the end, in that time frame, whenever God's wrath is hitting humanity. And we, even now, where we sit, there's things that are taking place before our very eyes. And most of the church is even oblivious to what's going on. And they won't even tell the people and warn the people and try to prepare the people that this is serious. Amen? And that we have to have our eyes open. We have to be sober. Amen?
Yes.
Thank you, Lord. We just thank you in Jesus' name.